So our today's topic is the skeletal system, and you know that skeletal system is actually the skeleton. Okay, so this is your skeletal system. Skeletal system consists of bones and the joints. Okay, bones and the joints. Whole skeleton is divided into two parts: axial part or axial skeleton, and appendicular part or appendicular skeleton. Axial skeleton is the middle part, consists of the skull, thoracic case, and the vertebral column. So those three belong to the axial skeleton. I'm repeating again: the skull, thoracic case, and the vertebral column. Appendicular skeleton consists of the upper and lower extremities, that means upper limbs and lower limbs. Those belong to the appendicular skeleton. So today we'll talk about the axial skeleton. So we'll talk about the bones of the skull, thoracic case, and the vertebral column. In axial skeleton, you have total 80 bones. In this picture, you can see by two different colors the axial and appendicular parts or skeleton have been shown. So the cyan color or bluish color is showing the axial skeleton, and the yellowish color is showing the appendicular skeleton. So first we'll talk about the bones of the skull. Your skull consists of two sets of bones, or two groups of bones: cranial bones that enclose the brain, the most important organ, is protected by and supported by the cranial bones, right? You have 8 cranial bones, and facial bones form the framework of your face. So the framework of the face is given by the facial bones. There are total 14 facial bones. So how many cranial bones you have? 8. And how many facial? 14. Okay, those two groups of bones together form the skull. So those are the skull bones. Facial bones provide the attachment to the facial muscles, and the muscles of mastication. Mastication means chewing. When you chew the food, that is mastication. Okay, so facial bones provide attachment to the facial muscles, that means muscles of facial expression. Muscles of facial expression. Okay, and muscles of mastication. Okay, muscles of mastication. So those two types of muscles are attached to the facial bones. That means the facial bones provide the attachment to the muscles. Those help in the expression of face. When you get angry or happy or sad, right? The expression of face changes. So those muscles are attached to the facial bones. Number two, muscles of mastication. You use those muscles to chew and swallow the food. Okay? Those muscles are also supported by the facial bones. Facial bones form cavities for special sense organs. For example, facial bones form the orbital fossa for the eyeballs, nasal cavity for the nose, oral cavity or mouth. So those cavities are formed by the facial bones, and you know that those cavities hold the eyeballs, right? Nose, your tongue. So those special sense organs are located inside those or housed inside those cavities. Facial bones form the passages or openings for the air and food passes. So again, nasal cavity is the passage for air, oral cavity or mouth is for the food. So those are some important functions of your facial bones. And cranial bones, as I have mentioned, support and protect the brain, the most important organ of your body. Also, few muscles get attached to the cranial bones, and some of them help in mastication. Here you see that two groups of bones, cranial bones in the top left and facial bones in the bottom right. Cranial bones are articulated or attached to each other by sutures. Sutures are the joints where the cranial bones get attached to each other. Cranial bones are held together by the sutures. And sutures are immovable joints. Sutures are the joints where no movement occurs. No movement occurs. Eight cranial bones. What are the eight cranial bones? You have one frontal bone, two parietal bones, one occipital bone, two temporal bones, one sphenoid, and one ethmoid. You need to remember these names. Okay, so these are eight cranial bones. Among these eight cranial bones, you see parietal and temporal. Those are paired. That means two in number. Others are only one. Your frontal bone is in this part of the skull, forehead. So this is the frontal, and behind the frontal you have two parietals. They meet at the sagittal suture, mid sagittal line here. Okay, like this. So two parietal bones meet at the midline at sagittal suture. Then under the parietal bones you have the temporal bones. Okay, under the ear you have the temporal bones here. And then in the back of the skull you have the occipital. So occipital bone is in the back. So you got frontal, two parietals, two temporals, one occipital. Now ethmoid and sphenoid, those bones are located in the base of the skull. They form the floor of the skull. So it's difficult to see from outside. Okay, only small part you can see from outside, if you look through the orbital fossa or nasal cavity, small part, you will be able to see. But mostly they are hidden. So those are 8 cranial bones. This is the front view of the skull. So if you see the skull from the front of the skull, you see the frontal bone in the forehead area, the front of the skull. Then behind that, 2 parietal bones. You can see only a small part of parietal bones. And under the parietal bone, you have the temporal bones, right? And you see the occipital is in the back, so you don't see it here. If you look through the orbital fossa, cavity for the eye, you can see a small part of sphenoid and ethmoid. Okay, so some of the bones, cranial bones, you can see if you look the skull from the front. Now, as I have mentioned, that cranial bones are attached to each other by the sutures. So important sutures of your skull are coronal suture, sagittal suture, lambdoid suture, and squamous suture. So those are the main sutures. So you need to know their names and which bones are joined by those sutures. First, coronal suture. Coronal suture is here. See, here, you know, frontal or coronal plane. You remember from the lab part. So here, and coronal suture articulates the frontal and parietal. Okay, so here. Then sagittal suture is in the midline. This is the sagittal plane. You know that, right? Mid sagittal. So 2 parietal bones are joined at the sagittal suture. Lambdoid suture is in the back here. Articulates the parietal and occipital. And then squamous is above the ear. Ear articulates the parietal and temporal. So those are the main sutures in your skull. Here you see those sutures. So you can go over coronal suture. Then mid sagittal suture or sagittal suture you don't see here because you are looking the skull from the side. So if you look from the side, you won't be able to see this one, right? Because this is the top. So you are looking this way. Here you can see this is the back of the skull. So you can see sagittal and the lambdoid. Lambdoid articulates the parietal and occipital. So this is the occipital bone. In the back. If you see the skull from the bottom, this is the bottom of the skull. You will see many openings are present, many holes are present under the skull. Why is that? What do you think? Nerves and blood vessels, right? Arteries, veins. Because you know that your brain is there inside the skull, right? So the nerves, some nerves get out, some nerves enter into the brain. And also blood vessels. Arteries enter into the brain, veins come out from the brain. So for those structures, you have those openings. Those are called, usually, those are called foramen. Foramen means round or almost round opening. But not all openings are round. So just know that for the nerves and the blood vessels. Now, the largest foramen is the foramen magnum. Magnum means big. Magnum means big. So, foramen magnum, you see the biggest one. It is in the occipital bone. Okay? And the spinal cord gets out from the skull through the foramen magnum. So that's the opening for the spinal cord. And here you can see the sphenoid bone very clearly. You see the in the middle part, that red color bone is the sphenoid bone. It looks like a butterfly. It looks like a flying butterfly or bat. So that's the sphenoid. Okay, so we'll just go over few cranial bones and their important features. So this is a temporal bone. Temporal bone, if you see this bone carefully, you see the upper part of this bone has just a flat piece of bone. So in the upper part of temporal bone, you have just a piece of flat bone. And that part is called the squamous part or squamous region. In the lower part of the temporal bone, you have a number of structures. So lower part is irregular. What are the structures you have in the lower part? Three processes. You have three processes. You have one fossa, one meatus. Okay, so those are the structures you have in the lower part of the temporal bone. What are the three processes? Three processes are zygomatic process, styloid process, and mastoid process. Zygomatic process, you see the extended bony structure that goes to the zygomatic bone. That's why this part is called the zygomatic process of the temporal bone, because it goes to the zygomatic bone. Then you should see a sharp, narrow process directed downwards. That narrow, sharp process is called the styloid process. Very pointed. Okay. And behind that, you have a blunt, round process. Not sharp, not pointed, blunt and round. That is called the mastoid process. You can actually feel your mastoid process. It's behind your ear lobule. If you just put your finger here, you see the rounded kind of elevation. That's the mastoid process of the temporal bone. And do you feel that? Okay, so mastoid process becomes painful if you have ear infection. So sometimes doctors can tell that if you have ear infection, they will press the mastoid process, because inside the mastoid process you have spaces. It's not a solid piece of bone. Okay, so you have spaces. So pus or dead cells or tissue can accumulate, fluid can accumulate there and can cause pain because you have spaces inside the mastoid process. So if you press there, you will feel pain. So those are three processes. In the test, if I ask you which one is very sharp pointed process, styloid process, right? Which one is blunt round mastoid, right? So those are the lecture exam type question. In the lab, this chapter is also very important for your lab, because in the lab a huge number of questions will be from the bones. So I can put that bone and ask you, what bone is this? This is the temporal bone, right? Which bone is this? Which structure is this or that? So this chapter is very important for both your lecture and lab. So three processes. Then one fossa. What's the name of that fossa? Mandibular fossa. Why this fossa? First, what is fossa? Fossa is a depression in the bone, like this. And why you have fossa there in the temporal bone, and that is called mandibular fossa? Because the mandible gets attached there and from the temporomandibular joint. So the mandible gets attached to the fossa like this. And that's why it is called the mandibular fossa, fossa for the mandible. Then you have the external acoustic meatus. Meatus is canal-like structure in the bone. So outer ear canal, that's the external acoustic meatus. So those are the parts of the temporal bone. This is a sphenoid bone. It looks like what I said? Sphenoid looks like
butterfly or bat.
Butterfly or bat, yeah. So it has a body part and wings like a butterfly, body and wings. Middle portion is the body of sphenoid, okay? And in both sides you have wings. How many wings? Two pairs, not two. That means four wings. One pair are called the greater wings because they are greater, bigger. And the other pair is called the lesser wings. So let's see. So this is the body, and this is a greater wing here. This is another greater wing. And these two are lesser wings. You see, small, lesser wings. Now, as you have already seen, that this bone is located in the bottom of the skull, in the middle part of the bottom of the skull. On the top of the body, that means in the upper surface of the body, you have a fossa, again, fossa, like this, right? Where the pituitary gland sits in. So the pituitary gland, the master gland, you remember? The master gland is the pituitary gland, fits into that fossa, rests there. And that's why this fossa is called the hypophyseal fossa. Why it is called hypophyseal fossa? Because the another name of the pituitary gland is hypophysis. So hypophysis is the other name of the pituitary gland. That's why it is called hypophyseal fossa, fossa for the pituitary gland. I may ask this, okay? On the body, you have that. Then you see, under the lesser wing, you have canal. So you have two canals under two lesser wings, and those are called optic canals. Optic nerve from your eyeball enters into the brain. So optic nerves, two optic nerves enter into the brain through those canals. That's why they are called optic canal. Then in the back of the greater wing, you have a nice oval foramen. That's why they are called oval foramen or foramen oval. Oval shape, like egg shape, foramen. So you have two optic canals for optic nerves and two oval foramen for the blood vessels. Now, this is an ethmoid bone. Ethmoid bone is mainly located inside the nose. Most part of it is inside the nose. If you see an ethmoid bone, it has a middle part and two lateral muscles. A middle portion and two lateral muscles. First, we'll see the middle portion. You see, in the middle portion, you have a part that is going upwards like this. That extended part of middle portion which is going upwards, that is called crista galli. Crista galli. That extended bony part directed upwards or extended upwards. Then in the lower part of middle portion you have a flat bone like this. Flat bone, plate of bone is going downwards. That flat piece of bone is called the perpendicular plate of ethmoid. Perpendicular plate of ethmoid. Now, perpendicular plate of ethmoid forms the nasal septum, the bony nasal septum that separates the nose into two halves. So, a part, just write it down, a part of nasal septum, the partition inside the nasal cavity is formed by the perpendicular plate of ethmoid. Because you see, it is going down like this. A plate, flat plate is going downwards. So it will divide the nasal cavity into two. Okay, so in the middle portion, you've got crista galli and perpendicular plate of ethmoid. Which one is directed upwards? Crista galli. And downwards, the plate? Perpendicular plate of ethmoid. Now, in both sides of crista galli, you have cribriform plate. And if you see, when you see the bone in the lab, you'll see there are many tiny holes are present in the cribriform plates. And those holes are called olfactory foramina. Now, foramen, I already have mentioned that foramen is round or almost round opening, right, in the bone, foramen. Foramina are tiny foramen. That means very small holes. That's why they are called foramina. So, many tiny small holes are present in the cribriform plate. Those are called olfactory foramina. Why olfactory? Because from the nose, olfactory nerve fibers, you know, the smell is taken to the brain by the olfactory nerve fibers. Many olfactory nerve fibers enter into the brain through the cribriform plate, olfactory foramina of the cribriform plate. So this is the cribriform plate, you see, and you have many holes. Those are olfactory foramina. These are olfactory nerve fibers from the nose go to the brain. So that's the middle portion. Okay, in lateral masses, you have many air cells. That means many small cavities air-filled cavities. You see there, these two are lateral masses and many air cells or air sinuses are present in the lateral masses. So that's the ethmoid bone. Here you can see actually the top part of ethmoid, only the very upper part, because most part is inside the nose. This is the very top part of the ethmoid. So you see this is crista galli and cribriform plate. You see many holes, foramina, olfactory foramina. Okay, so that's the very upper part of the ethmoid bone. And you see the red color, that's the sphenoid, the butterfly. Okay, so now we'll see the facial bones. We have 14 facial bones, I have already mentioned. What are those? You have one mandible, two maxillary bones or maxilla, two zygomatic bones, two nasal bones, two lacrimal bones, two palatine bones, one vomer, and two inferior nasal concave. So you see, most of the bones are paired, two in number, except the mandible and the vomer. Others are two. Okay. Mandible, the largest and strongest bone of the face, number one. Number two, only freely movable bone. This is the only bone of your skull which moves a lot. Other bones have almost no movement. Okay, so only freely movable bone is the mandible. And mandible articulates with the temporal bone. You remember I told you the mandibular fossa in the temporal bone where the mandible fits. So that's the joint between temporal and temporal bone and mandible, and forms the temporomandibular joint. Some of you have probably heard TMJ, temporomandibular joint. Here, where sometimes locked jaw, have you heard locked jaw? That happens. The patient opens mouth but cannot close. Gets stuck there. Okay, so that's the temporomandibular joint. And this is the only joint where a lot of movement occurs in the skull. Okay, so mandible is the lower jaw bone is the mandible. So this is the mandible parts. Mandible has three parts. We divide this bone into three parts: the body of mandible, then ramus, and in between you have mandibular angle. So body, ramus, and mandibular angle. Now remember, the word ramus means arm-like part. This is your arm, you know, that arm-like part of the bone. So if any bone has arm-like part, we can name it as ramus. For example, this is your mandible and this is the body, the lower part, this is the angle, and this is the arm-like part, right? So this is the ramus of the mandible. Make sense? Okay, so you have two ramus in the mandible. Now first we'll see the body. upper border of the body, you have the lower teeth attached. So the lower teeth are attached to the upper border of the mandible, and that upper border where the lower teeth are attached is called the alveolar margin. Alveolar margin is the upper border of the body of the mandible where the lower teeth are attached. Then in each side of the body you have a foramen opening. That foramen is called the mental foramen. So you have two mental foramen, one in each side of the body. Now you see here, your mental foramens are here. In first lab, you have learned which area is this, mental area, right? Chin is the mental area. Cheek is the buccal or buccal area, right? So since this area is the mental area, those foramen are called mental foramen. Make sense? Okay, so blood vessels and nerve enter through that foramen. So that's the body. Now we'll see the ramus of the mandible. You see, in the upper part of the ramus, you have two structures. A flat bony structure in the front, that is called the coronoid process, and a round structure in the back, that is called the mandibular condyle. Okay, so the front one is flat, thin bony structure, that is the coronoid process, and in the back you have kind of like this, you see, round structure, that is called the mandibular condyle. Now you remember temporomandibular joint. In the temporal bone you had a fossa, right? You have a fossa, and this mandibular condyle fits into it. So round fits into it, makes sense, and forms the temporomandibular joint. Is it clear? Okay. So those two structures in the upper part. Now in the inner surface, so if this is the ramus, in the inner surface of the ramus you have a foramen, that is called the mandibular foramen. So you have two mental foramen in the body and two mandibular foramen in the ramus. Both foramen are the passages for the nerves and blood vessels. So if I ask you, only movable joint is what in the skull? Temporomandibular joint, right? Only movable bone is the, freely movable bone is the mandible, right? Lower jaw bone is the mandible. The strongest and largest bone is the mandible, right? So I can ask many questions like this. Make sense? Okay. So maxillary bone. You have two maxillary bones or maxilla. They join together and form the upper jaw. So this is the upper jaw, and two maxillary bones join at the midline and form the upper jaw. This bone is located, if you just think, this bone is located in the center of the face, right? In the center of the face, and it holds the facial bones together. So that's why, because of those two reasons, this bone is called the keystone bone. Keystone. It is located centrally and it holds most of the facial bones or hold them. It holds all the facial bones except the mandible. Mandible is only attached to the temporal bone at temporomandibular joint, you know that. So mandible is not attached to the maxilla, but all other facial bones are attached. This is a maxillary bone or maxilla. First, you see in the lower part of this bone, the upper teeth are attached. So upper teeth are attached to the lower part of this bone. Same as mandible, the area where the teeth are attached, that area is called the alveolar margin. Now this bone has two processes. One is directed upwards. See here, this is your maxilla, so one process is going to the frontal bone. This is the frontal bone, right? So that's why this is called the frontal process of maxilla. And another process is from the maxilla going towards the zygomatic bone. That's why this is called the zygomatic process of maxilla. So two processes like this. Make sense? So one is going towards what? Frontal bone. So that is the frontal process. Make sense? And another is going towards what? The zygomatic bone. So that's the zygomatic process of the maxilla. So if you think when you will study the bone, why the name is like that, it will make things very easy, okay? But if you don't think, try to remember, it will be difficult, okay? So those are two processes. Inside the maxilla, you have the largest cavity in the bones. That is the maxillary sinus. Sinus is the air-filled cavity inside the bone. So the largest sinuses are the maxillary sinuses.
Are they not labeled on there?
No, because it is inside. So maxillary sinus or cavity, air cavity, is inside the maxillary bone, and this is the largest sinus or cavity in your skeleton. You know, sometimes inflammation of the sinus is called what? Sinusitis. Itis is the inflammation, right? Any itis. If you hear, start from head, meningitis, right? Conjunctivitis, rhinitis, tonsillitis, pericarditis, hepatitis, nephritis, right? So any itis. If you are, that means inflammation of that structure. So inflammation of the sinus is what? Sinusitis. Okay. And when inflammation occurs, microorganisms can infect the mucosal lining, and fluid will be secreted, and that cavity will get filled with fluid. You'll feel heaviness of the head, right? Pain, all those symptoms. Zygomatic bones. Just know that zygomatic bones are the cheek bones. They form the prominence of your cheek. The prominence of your cheek is given by the zygomatic bones. And zygomatic bone forms the lower part of the orbit. Or orbital fossa. This is the orbital fossa or orbit. So the lower part is formed by the zygomatic bone. Makes sense. Two nasal bones form the bridge of your nose. So the bridge of nose is formed by the nasal bones. And you have two lacrimal bones form the medial wall of the orbit. So medial wall of the orbit is formed by two lacrimal bones. In your lacrimal bone, you have a fossa. You already know fossa is a depression like this. So in lacrimal bone, you have a fossa that is called the lacrimal fossa that houses the lacrimal sac. Sac is fluid-filled membranous structure. So, lacrimal sac, see here, if this is the lacrimal fossa, this is the lacrimal sac filled with fluid, fits here, housed there. Now, lacrimal sac contains the fluid and that fluid is your tear. When you cry after the exam, right, that's the, that comes from the lacrimal sac. That's the tear, the fluid, okay? And when you cry the from the sac, the tear gets out through the duct, lacrimal duct, the tube, and drains into the, goes to the eye. Here you see now, you can see the mandible, lower jaw, maxilla, upper jaw. Then you see the zygomatic bone forms the cheek, and you see the nasal bone. So two nasal bones come like this and form the base of the nose. And then you have the lacrimal bone. You see the green color from the medial wall of the orbital fossa. So those facial bones you can see from outside. Inside the nose, you have other facial bones. Okay, now palatine bones, very easy. Palatine bones form what? Palate, hard palate. What is palate? Now you need to know what is palate, right? Palate is the roof of the mouth, right? So if you put your finger inside the mouth and move up or move your tongue up, you will touch the palate. So that is formed by the palatine bones. That's why its name is palatine bone. Now, it forms a part of the hard palate, not the whole hard palate. Posterior one-third part of the hard palate, because you see here, your palate is here. So which bone is this? Maxilla. So maxilla forms anterior part, right? And palatine bone forms the posterior part. So anterior two-third is formed by the maxilla, and posterior one-third of hard palate is formed by the palatine bones. So very easy. If I ask you which two bones form the palate, front part is by what? Maxilla. And back part by palatine bone. Palatine bones also form the posterior lateral wall of the nasal cavity and a small part of the orbit, but mainly the part of hard palate. Vomer, plow-shaped bone, and forms a part of your nasal septum. Now you tell me, I mentioned nasal septum before. Did I? Which bones form the upper part of nasal septum? Perpendicular plate of ethmoid, right? Remember, the perpendicular plate of ethmoid goes down like this, I told you, forms the upper part of the nasal septum, right? And lower part you see here, this is the perpendicular plate of ethmoid, forms the upper part coming from above, and the vomer from lower part. So this is the bony part of nasal septum, okay? So nasal septum, bony part is formed by those two bones, ethmoid and vomer. Now we have cartilaginous part also, you can feel that, you know, that in the front part, it is soft, right? It moves. So that's the cartilaginous part. In the back, you have the bony part. So if I ask you in the test, which two bones form the palate, hard palate? Anterior two-third by? Maxilla, posterior one-third by palatine bone, because it is palate. And which two bones form the bony part or hard part of nasal septum? Of ethmoid above and which one below? Vroma. Make sense? Okay. Sounds like you are very smart. Good. Okay, here you see the nasal septum and the hard palate. So first let's see the hard palate again. This is the roof of the mouth or hard palate. Anterior 2/3, posterior 1/3. And this is the nasal septum. This is the cartilaginous part that you can move, the soft part. And in the back, you have the hard part formed by these two bones. Okay. Okay. Now, we'll talk about the paranasal sinuses. I have already mentioned that sinuses are air-filled spaces or cavities inside the bones, right? Air-filled cavities or spaces. Around the nose, you have a number of sinuses around the nose. Those are called paranasal sinuses. So, what are the important paranasal sinuses? Inside the frontal bone, in this part, you have frontal sinuses. Inside the frontal bone, frontal sinuses, right? Inside the ethmoid bone, you remember in lateral masses, you have many air cells. So, those are air sinuses or cells in ethmoid bone, ethmoidal air cells or sinuses. Then, the largest sinus is inside which bone? Inside the maxilla, right? So, maxillary sinuses. You see the red color in both sides of the nose. And also, you have sphenoidal sinus inside that butterfly-shaped bone. So, those are the paranasal sinuses. Normally, they are filled with what? Air. But if infection occurs, that is called what? Sinusitis. And in that case, fluid will be secreted from the mucous cell, right? And will fill the cavity. So, those are the paranasal sinuses. Now, why you have those paranasal sinuses? Anybody? What do you think? What's the advantage? What's the disadvantage of having paranasal sinuses? What do you think? Why you have so many sinuses in that part of the body, not in other bones? Number one, those sinuses make the head part of the body light. Otherwise, your head part will be very heavy if, you know, solid bones are there. So, make the skull lighter. Number two, because of those sinuses, the sound you produce, the quality of sound improves. Quality of sound is improved by those sinuses. Okay. Now, the problem of having sinuses is sinusitis, right? You'll see many people suffer from sinusitis. That's the problem, right? Inflammation of the sinus occurs. Hyoid bone. Hyoid bone is the lonely bone of your skeleton. This bone is called what? Lonely bone. Why it is called lonely bone? Because it doesn't have any? It doesn't have any friend. That's why it is lonely. Right? It doesn't have any friend. Why we say that? Because, number one, it is not attached to any bone. It is just hang by the ligaments here, the upper part of the front of the neck, that means below the chin here, and this bone is not physically attached to any bone, just hanging there by the ligaments. Okay, you remember the stellar process of temporal bone, very sharp pointed. From there, the ligaments come and hold that bone. Number two, nobody wants to take this bone as its part. For example, when we talk about a skull bone, we don't include hyoid. When we talk about vertebrae, we don't include hyoid. We said no, vertebrae said no, he's not our part. Skull bones said no, he's not our part, right? So it doesn't belong to any group. Not in a skull bone, not in vertebral column, or not in thoracic case. Okay, now why that bone is important? This is the only bone here, you see, that supports the anterior neck muscles, because you have several muscles here, and this is the only bone that supports the anterior neck muscles. Anterior neck muscles get attached to the hyoid. And you know that anterior neck muscles are very important. Why? Because when you swallow the food, these muscles help. When you speak, produce speech, these muscles are used, right? So some of these muscles are used to swallow the food. Some of these muscles are used to produce the speech. So those important muscles are supported or held by the hyoid bone. This is, you see, the location in the upper picture, and lower one is showing the hyoid bone, the parts. Hyoid bone has a body and two pairs of horns, not wings, two pairs of horns, greater horns and lesser horns. Vertebral column or spine. Vertebral column consists of five groups of bones. Yeah, from the top, if you see in the cervical part, you have how many? Seven cervical vertebrae. Then in the thoracic part, you have 12 thoracic vertebrae. Then in the lumbar part, you have five lumbar vertebrae, and then below the lumbar, you have the sacrum. In early life, the sacrum is not a single bone. Actually, in early life, you have five pieces of sacral vertebrae, right? And at around age 15 or 16, those vertebrae, those five pieces of sacral vertebrae, they fuse together and form one large triangular bone, that is the sacrum. Okay, and then below the sacrum, you have the tail bones, coccyx. Coccyx, the number of coccyx is not fixed. It varies person to person. It could be 3 to 6 pieces. Okay, 3 to 6 pieces. It's not fixed. So those are the five groups of bones, okay, or five types of bones in the vertebral column or in your spine. Now, what are the functions of your vertebral column? Number one, you can write it down, keeps the body erected. To keep the body erected, straight stand, you need the vertebral column. Number two, houses and protects the spinal cord. Houses and protects the spinal cord. Number three, transmission of body weight from the upper part of the body goes down to the vertebral column to your leg bones. So transmission of body weight. So those are the most important functions of your vertebral column. Now, the vertebrae are attached to each other by intervertebral discs. So, body of vertebrae are attached to each other. The bodies of vertebrae are attached to each other by intervertebral discs. So, the intervertebral discs consists of intervertebral disc has two parts. The outer part is called annulus fibrosus and the inner part is called nucleus pulposus. Very easy way to remember. Nucleus is located usually where? In the center, right? So if you hear nucleus, that means the center part, okay? Nucleus pulposus. Do you know the word annular? Ring-like, ring. Okay, so annulus means ring, ring-shaped structure. So now you see, this is a ring, right? This is a ring. So this is the annulus and this is what? The center part, right? So this is the nucleus. Make sense? So this is nucleus pulposus. This is annulus fibrosus, the ring around the nucleus. So now if I ask you which one is fibrous structure, its name is telling you. Which one? Annulus is the fibrous, right? That means it is tough. Remember, always fibrous structures of your body are tough, very tough. Fibers provide toughness. And so the outer part has a lot of connective tissue fibers. So this is the hard structure, annulus fibrosus, ring of fibers. And nucleus pulposus is soft, jelly-like structure. Soft, jelly-like structure is the nucleus pulposus, soft. Now, intervertebral discs provide cushioning, shock absorber, absorbs shock. If you jump from height and land on the ground, if your bones, if there was no intervertebral disc, the bones will easily get crushed, right? Because of that, you know, structure in between vertebrae, intervertebral disc, the shock is absorbed. Now, here, this is the vertical section. You see the nucleus pulposus inner part, annulus fibrosus outer part. Okay? Slipped disc or herniated disc. It is a clinical condition. Sometimes it can happen due to sudden movement of the body, or if you jump from height because of the weight or pressure, what can happen? The disc can slip out. And that is called the herniated or slipped disc. That can cause a serious problem because in the back of the intervertebral disc, you have the spinal nerves. You see from both sides of the spinal cord, the spinal nerves get out and they are located just behind the intervertebral disc. So you see in the right side of this picture, the location is normal. But in the left side, if you see in this picture, you see a part has pushed backward and it can press the spinal nerve. You can push the spinal nerve or press it, and that will cause severe pain in that part of the body supplied by that particular spinal nerve. Serious painful condition can occur by slipped disc or herniated disc. Okay, make sense? Got it? Have you heard hernia? The word hernia? What is that? Hernia is movement of any structure from its normal to abnormal position. Any structure of your body, if it moves from its normal position to abnormal position, that is hernia. So this is what? Herniated what? Disc, right? If your eyeball comes out from the fossa, we will say herniated eye. Make sense? If your intestine, part of intestine moves out from its normal position, we'll say herniated intestine. So, movement from its normal to abnormal location is the hernia, inguinal hernia. What happens? You have the tube that is called inguinal canal. If the spermatic cord comes out from there, that is the inguinal hernia. Make sense? Coming out. Okay. So let's stop here since the time is almost over. We'll talk last few slides about last few slides in a minute.